Before we get started in this morning, I want to have to, last week or so, we got a couple of applications for membership for the church here. And we looked at them, and you know, Ed and Susan Hepworth and everything, and we saw Ed's and went immediately, yeah, we'll accept Ed, Susan. Well, you know, we prayed a little bit, but no, I'm just giving her a hard time. Absolutely not. It's with great pleasure to welcome you guys as members of Beacon Bible Church. Of course, that does mean you get to dust the chandeliers, but you know. Welcome and thank you. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, that we can come here and draw close to you, Lord. Father, that you desire us to come before your throne to just be children at home with you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for this time of fellowship with you and one another. And Lord, as we get into your word, that is that lamp unto our feet, Lord, that light to our path that shows us who you are and helps us to follow you, Lord Jesus, that teaches us, that nourishes us, that grows us in your name, Lord Jesus. We pray, Lord, as always, that as we get into your word, that your word would get into us. Teach us who you are, Lord Jesus, and then use us. In your name we pray. Amen. Open your Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Last time as we got into this book in our opening part here, we got all the way to verse 3. In Paul's greeting, once again, it's kind of Paul's typical greeting, but as always, there's more meat to that greeting than just, hi, how you doing? He reminds us that he's the apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, not his own will. That is the Lord that has sent him out. He sends it to the church of God, reminding us who we belong to. With all the saints, he says there, and that would be us, that idea of being saints. We talked about that. There's two kinds of people in the world, right? We remember that? Saints and ain'ts. You're either saved or you're not. And it's the Lord that refers to us as saints, being set apart, separated from the world. It's not, doesn't mean that we're perfect and all that, but he calls us saints, so who are we to argue with him? Talks about the grace and peace from our God, our Father, and our Lord Jesus Christ, and being the source of that grace and the source of that peace. In verse 3, he said, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble, with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also abounds through Christ. Now if we are afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation, which is effective for enduring the same sufferings which we also suffer. For if we are confronted, are comforted, it is for your consolation and salvation. And our hope for you is steadfast, because we know that as you are partakers of the sufferings, so also you will be partakers of the consolation. Verse 3, we hung out there with these ideas with these facts about the nature of our Heavenly Father. Now, he is our Father, and that means a lot to us. He's not just the God of heaven and earth, but he's our Father, our Heavenly Father, our God Almighty. He's ours. We're his. And he is the Father of all mercies. In this instance, in this context, he's sort of speaking about the mercies, the compassion that he has for us. He's God of compassion and the God of all comfort. Our Heavenly Father is compassionate towards us, merciful towards us, His children. And again, the idea of compassion here, it's not just that emotional feeling sorry for us, although there's plenty to feel sorry about, isn't there? It's that recognizing our situation, our need, and acting on it. Compassion is more of an action than it is the emotion. There's a lot of things that we see in life that we feel sorry for or sorry about. We have sympathy for others and everything. But as we have compassion, it's that compassion that moves us to do things. So He's our Father of mercies, compassion, and the God of all comfort. We talked about Him being our Father who has the desire to comfort us. Isaiah 66, it had the picture of the baby being kind of bounced around and comforted on her knee, you know. We've all been around little babies that like to cry for no reason that we can understand, you know. And you kind of take them and hold them and cuddle them and bounce them and do whatever, you know, whatever it is to get them settled, to get them comforted. And that was the kind of idea that we got out of that, that our Heavenly Father wants to do that. The notion that our Heavenly Father wants us to come, you know, and climb up into His lap in those times of need. He says, come boldly before our throne in your times of need and find help, right? Where does He want us to be? We can think back at our own childhood and our own parents and whoever, you know, when things hurt, you run to them. You know, I remember being a little kid and being barefoot and stepping right through into the middle of one of those sticker bushes, you know, the little goat heads with all those little stickers in them. Oh. You know, and right then and there, it says, I wasn't going to run anywhere, but I went, ah! You know, it's that same thing. You know, our Heavenly Father wants us to come to Him, to reach out to Him. So something that the love of Christ, the grace and the mercy of Christ reaches down to us as we reach up to Him. And we cry out, Abba, Father. And He picks us up and takes us in and says, beloved children, and our Father who comforts us, the God of all comfort. Verse 4, He says, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. Now, when you're going through something, you're dealing with something, you want to know that you want somebody to come alongside you that knows what it means to be comforted, doesn't it? Somebody that can help you get your focus back on the Lord. Somebody that can point you in that right direction. That can come alongside you and say, you know what? The Lord loves you and He's going to care for you through this thing. And I know that because He's done it for me. You don't have to necessarily understand the situation. You don't have to be able to. You don't have to have gone through that very same circumstances. You know, we always try to say, well, I know how you feel. Well, you can say that because we know what it feels like to be in need of comforting from our Father, don't we? We've all been in a situation like that. You know, I may not be able to relate to your particular situation, but I know what it means to be in that place of wanting comfort. He says there that our Father of all comforts, the God of all comforts, who comforts us in all of our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any tribulation. That word tribulation and trials, we remember James chapter 1. Go ahead and turn there. I know you know it, but let's read it again anyhow. James chapter 1 and verse 2, he says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Not the first thing that comes to mind, is it, to count it all joy? Oh boy, trials, let's go. We don't count it all joy in the sense that they necessarily make us happy, but verse 3, it says, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience, but let patience have its perfect work, that you might be perfected and complete, lacking nothing. So we count it all joy when we fall into these various trials. And again, I'll point out that it doesn't say if you fall into various trials, does it? is pretty plain. When you fall into these various trials, you know that the Lord is at work to produce this patience, that He's helping you to grow, that He's maturing you as a Christian, as a believer, so that we can grow and mature. It says perfect, but that has the idea of being complete, mature in Christ. It needs to grow us up. We can look back in the times in our walk with the Lord, and it's been through those trials that we've probably grown the most. And those trials and tribulations that come into our lives through many different ways, many different avenues, they come, don't they? And He says that He comforts us. Back into 2 Corinthians, it says, who comforts us in all of our tribulation. Not most, not some, not part, not the worst of them, not the easiest of them, not those times and those situations where you can't find comfort somewhere else, so nothing else works and you turn to the Lord. You ever been in that one? You ever come to the Lord and say, well, Lord, I've tried everything I can and I just can't find any comfort in this situation, so God help me. You know, where's the faith in that? Where's the trusting in your Heavenly Father? You know, but unfortunately, all too often, it's when we've exhausted every other means we see at our disposal that we go to our Heavenly Father. And He says, you know what? All you had to do is ask from the start. Come here in the beginning. You know, be quick to run to Him. Be quick to turn to Him with any of these trials and tribulations, whether they be big or small. It doesn't matter. It could be the biggest thing that's ever happened in your life, the most difficult trial you've ever been through. And come to Him and expect Him to see you through that trial. We come too often to the Lord knowing that He desires to help us and in this trial, and we just say, well, Lord, deliver me from this. You know, going back to that little sticker patch, boy, I wanted delivered from that thing right there. There's no way I wanted to be seen through that. You know, and that's what I got too, was delivered. You know, but we come to the Lord in these times of trial knowing that He's our loving Heavenly Father and that He can see us through these things. He doesn't always deliver us through them, does He? And I find out that as we grow in the Lord, there's less deliverance and more seeing through these things. And the reason that He does it, that He brings us through these things instead of just simply delivering us from them, is so that we grow in the Lord, so that we mature. Have any of you ever been around someone whose parents have always just sort of bailed them out of everything? By the time they get to be adults, you wish that they hadn't, huh? They don't take any responsibility. They're not very useful to others. They don't comfort anyone. They expect to be just bailed out. And the Lord teaches us and grows us up and matures us through these things. James tells us so that it produces patience in us, completeness, maturity, and our faith and our trust in the Lord grow as we see Him fulfill His promises to us. As our Father says, come on, I will lead you through this. You can always go back to Psalm 23 and walking through the valley of the shadow of death. That doesn't have anything with doing. That has everything to do with living our life here under the shadow of death. And yet He leads us and He comforts us and takes care of us and brings us to those places where we have the green pastures and the still water and all that. Where we have that supper before our enemies, and we look and we see goodness and mercy that has followed us all the days of our life. It's always interesting to talk to people, to believers, and it doesn't matter whether they're fairly new believers or if they've been walking with the Lord for quite some time. Every one of them can turn around and see, you know what? Goodness and mercy there. We might recognize it a little more as believers, as we mature, but it's always been there. And that part about our cup running over, and the Lord hasn't just barely got us through by the skin of our teeth, has He? You know, when we do things on our own, we might get through some stuff, but boy, when we get on the other side, we're going, oh, that was horrible. I hope I never have to do that again. I got through this by the skin of my teeth. When the Lord sees us through that place, we're in those green pastures and the still water with the supper before our enemies, an overflowing cup going, praise God, thank you for taking me through that. Amen. You ever watch that? Read that book about the shepherd's look at Psalm 23. It's a good book. It's got some interesting insight and everything. And one of the things he talks about is going, everybody wants to be on a mountaintop, you know? You got these people that want to go climb Mount Everest. Why, I don't know. Like, there's nothing up there I need. I like it where it's warm. You know? And many people lose their lives trying to do it. You know, the greatest struggle and the hardest thing that they do is climb that mountain. And when you get up there to the top of those big peaks and everything like that, it's a very harsh environment up there where nothing grows. And very little can live there. It's when you come down to the valley on the other side that you find life and growth and all that. But too often we want to, oh, I want the mountaintop experience. All right, man. You know, I'd rather just kind of go around the mountain and, you know, take a picture when you get there, you know. He who comforts us in all of our tribulation, all of it, no matter what. He may not take it away, but he'll definitely see us through this. Whatever the difficult times, whatever the tribulation is, we turn to him for comfort. He says, why? He says, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble. It says we are able to comfort those who are in any trouble, not the same trouble. We're talking about that. I don't have to have experienced the same things you are to understand your need for comfort from the Lord. Because I've experienced that comfort. I know that every time that I've been in these situations and I look to the Lord, that the comfort is there. Every time. Not once has he let me down. Oh, there's been plenty of times where I've, you know, not really looked at him, to him, not really trusted in him, not really had faith in him, and done other things, but there's not one time where I've turned to him where he hasn't comforted me and seen me through these things. And the outcome of it, the result of it, is that now we're in a place where we can come alongside someone else and say, you know what, let's turn to the Lord, let's go to him in prayer, let's get in the Word, let's put our focus on him and have trust and faith in him. Believe in the Lord. Trust him to see you through this. It may not be easy, but he'll see you through it. I know because he's done it with me. The Lord will see you through, no matter what the tribulation is. And we can do this knowing, going from our experience with him. As we look back in our lives, we see that oftentimes in those times of trouble ourselves, it's when the Lord has brought somebody else, another believer, alongside of us and says, man, trust in the Lord because he's trustworthy, and encourage us in that way. And the Lord wants to use us in that. That's oftentimes the way that he comforts us, speaks of us as believers as being the body of Christ. So we want the hand and the arms of Christ to reach out to us, don't we? You know, as we come alongside one another and you put that arm around them, you give them that hug and you encourage them as the body of Christ. Yeah. Sometimes the Lord sends us in to do just that. It's not always what we say to somebody, but what we do that encourages them, that brings them to that place of finding that comfort that they need in the Lord. He's there to comfort us in all things. Look over at Philippians chapter 4 with me. Verse 4, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, verse 8, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The things which you have learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. Amen. Here in Philippians, the Lord is reminding us where we start at with these times of trouble. James said, count it all joy when you fall into trouble, into these times of tribulation. Here he says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, rejoice. In other places, the Bible tells us to give thanks in all things. Not necessarily for all things, but in all things, give thanks. Because no matter what we're going through, no matter what we're dealing with in this life, no matter what change it might bring in our circumstances, the one thing that we know for certain is that Jesus has not changed. Not one bit. Is there ever a time or a circumstance in your life where He's not praiseworthy? Is there ever a time or a circumstance in your life where there's not reason to give Him thanks? You're saved, you know Him, there's always reason to give Him thanks. Is there ever a time in your life, regardless of your circumstance, where you can't rejoice in the Lord? We look at these things and stuff that people deal with in their lives and everything, and oftentimes we as believers look at the situation and say, I can't imagine how they can deal with this without having the Lord in their life. And we look and we rejoice and we give thanks to the Lord that we don't have to deal with that, that we don't have to face it. No matter what comes our way, we know that we don't have to face it by ourselves. And no matter what happens, no matter what comes our way, we are with the Lord. We can trust in Him. So rejoice in the Lord always. I will say rejoice. Give thanks. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that I'm here with you and not here without you. It says, let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. He says in verse 6, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Be anxious for what? Nothing. How many things does that allow you to get anxious about? Nothing. Be anxious for nothing. Anxious, concerned, worried, to that point, worried is that being distracted, being consumed by something to the point of distraction. I'm worried about this so much that I've taken my eyes off the Lord and forgotten who He is and His love for me because of this thing that I'm focused on. You ever worry about stuff? Huh? No? Yeah? Why? What did the Bible tell? What did Jesus say? You worry, but it's not going to do you any good. It's not going to add one cubit, no stature, no nothing. It's not going to help. It will tear you down and tear you apart. You ever read Fox's Book of Martyrs? There's places in there where it talks about the people being worried by dogs. And that's just chewed up. And that's the picture I always get about worry. You know, sometimes that picture about worried by dogs, you know, it's great big old pit bulls and that kind of thing coming. And sometimes it's little chihuahuas. You know, you ever notice that? Them little chihuahuas, man, and it takes them a long time, but they will chew you up. Rotten little boogers. We see the big things that we worry about, and when you got that coming at you, most of the time, it's pretty easy to say, oh God, help me. to put your focus on Him and trust Him in that. But man, when them little chihuahuas are coming, it's like, well, what is this thing going to do to me? You know? We get worried, we get consumed, we get chewed up by this, we get anxious about that. It doesn't mean that we shouldn't be concerned about things, because we should, shouldn't we? We should be concerned, and we should take those concerns to the Lord with prayer and supplication. And that concern means we're coming to Him seeking that wisdom so that we can have our hearts and our minds on the same page that He is, trusting in Him, seeking His will. How do I do this? How do I deal with this? Should be concerned that we do God's will, God's way in all of these things. Not anxious, not distracted from God by these things, but these things draw us to Him as we go back and rejoice and give thanks. Count it all joy when we fall into these various trials. With prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to the Lord. You're praying, you're supplicating for others, for yourself. It's coming to the Lord, seeking His will. Lord, work in me, giving thanks. That thanksgiving is trusting in Him, isn't it? That focus on Him that brings you back to who He is. That you are Lord of my life. It's that trust in Him, and that believing and trusting in Him that brings us back to that place and that focus in our lives of Jesus and who He is. And we have that faith and that trust in Him that no matter what, we got our eyes on the Lord. It says, don't be anxious, but pray and give thanks. It says, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ. Talking about that peace of God. We talk about that a lot. We're at peace with God. And when we focus on Him, we can have the peace of God in our lives. And He's the one that supplies that through the Holy Spirit dwelling in us. We have that peace of God that enables us to stay focused on Him and spiritually, calmly walking through the worst times of our life, because we know that we can trust in Him. And that peace that we have guards our hearts and our minds. Where does this worry afflict us the most? Right up here, right? That's where it starts, man. It'll drive you crazy. Fortunately for most of us, it's not a long trip. Don't let them drive you crazy. Just walk, right? Not that far. But it'll drive you crazy as you start thinking about this thing and working these things and letting these thoughts run through your head that don't glorify the Lord, that aren't on Him. And then it's your hearts and your mind. The emotions. Talks about our hearts. It guards our emotions. Our emotions will drive us crazy too, right? Our emotions can bring us down so low, and can get us so far away from the Lord, can cause so much damage in our lives. Our emotions can take over and consume and drive us away from the Lord. But when we come back and we put our focus on Him, rejoicing, giving thanks in prayer and supplications, knowing who He is, then that peace is there and our minds can calm down. Wait a minute, I got all this stuff going on, but I know that my Heavenly Father is the God of all comfort and will see me through this. And our minds calm and our hearts calm. That peace of God guards our hearts and our minds, and we're not consumed and worried and eaten up by these things. But we go, praise God, I'm here with you, not without you. In verse 8 over here in Philippians, it says, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. Is there anything of the world that fits into this these categories that he's listed here? Truth? Not much. Noble? Not really. Just? Not often. Pure, lovely, of good report, virtue, if there is anything praiseworthy. Is there anything praiseworthy in your life? There's always something, isn't there? Yeah, you go back and you look at these things and people talk about making the list. All right, pros and cons. You know what? Forget the cons. Because what do they amount up to? In light of Jesus Christ and who He is. In light of our Heavenly Father and who He is. How do these things stack up? How do they even compare to the love of Christ that we have in our lives? You can have a long list of the cons. And all you got to do is put over on that other list, child of God. There's those places in the Scriptures where it goes through a bunch of different things, and then you find those little verses and it says, but God. Yeah, but God. And that takes care of all these other things, doesn't it? That's the only list you need. If you want to make a list of those things, you want to focus on that, start writing down the things that you know about Him. And then at the end, just to remind yourself, who is Lord of my life? Circumstances, my thoughts, my emotions, or my Jesus? You put your focus back on Him and meditate. It means focus. Focus on Him. We got the things out in the world that talk about meditate and everything. And it's, oh, let your mind go, let your mind be empty. You don't want to run around empty-headed. You want to do just the opposite. You want to focus on the Lord and fill your mind and your heart with the things of Christ. Not run around empty-headed. Paul says there in verse 9, he says, the things which you learned and have received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. It says the God of peace will be with you. Now you will realize that the God of peace is with you. You'll understand that. Paul says, I've been an example to you. Go back over to 2 Corinthians. Paul says, I've been an example to you. These things that you've seen and heard and watched in me, do these things. He talked about us being able to be comforted and comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by. Back in 2 Corinthians 1:4. We put our focus on the Lord. We walk that walk with Him. We walk through those things in our life, trusting, rejoicing, giving thanks in the Lord, praying with prayer and supplication and thanksgiving, having our focus be on Him with that peace that surpasses all understanding, our hearts and our minds guarded by that. Our focus on the Lord, and other people, believers or not, see that in us. We've all probably been in those circumstances where being a Christian and living our lives in the Lord and the example that that is for other people, that when things go wrong in their life, they come to us. Say, hey man, can I talk to you? Why do you want to talk to me? Well, you just always seem so calm and cool no matter what's going on. So I thought you might be able to help me. Well, first of all, I'm that way because of my relationship with Jesus Christ. Do you know Him? Because He's the one that can help you, not me. And we can point them to Him. In that time of suffering, they'll come to us. Believers want to find a fellow believer that they've seen walk through these things, through these trials and these tribulations. Keeping their focus on the things that are praiseworthy, the things of God in their life, not being consumed and worried by the other stuff. Those are the ones that you're drawn to, aren't you? You know, you got stuff going on in your life. You don't go grab the first person you see that's running around and, you know, doesn't know how to handle anything. You go find someone that has a solid walk with the Lord, that's been that example, just like Paul says. Hey, you've seen me do these things and live out those things before you. That rejoicing in the Lord, that being focused on Him, that prayer and supplication, that giving thanks. You know, we look through the book of Acts and all that, and we see Paul and his ministry and the things that the Scripture tell us. What did he do when he got beat up and thrown in jail? Got upset, disgusted, and said, "That's it, Lord, I quit," right? No, he didn't, did he? They went back there and they started singing and praising and all that, and the Lord come and sprung him out of jail. What did he do when he got shipwrecked? Well, praise God. Here we are, surfing in. Well, it says some of them came in on boards, right? They kept their focus on the Lord. Over here in Philippians, as we read that, those verses there, those five verses, it shows us to keep our focus on Him. And we see others that have done the same thing. And as we go through those trials, we know that it's not just to bring us to that place of maturity for our own good. People, Christians, believers, unfortunately, all too often are only focused on what the Lord is doing in them. Not that you shouldn't be aware of what the Lord's doing in there, not that there shouldn't be concern about that and your growth in the Lord, not that that shouldn't be a part of your relationship with Him. Lord, what are you doing in me? How are you growing me? But from there, you need to be concerned and aware of what the Lord's doing through you. And that's that pouring out and giving to others. We know the peace and the comfort of our Heavenly Father, don't we? Don't you? And others need to be pointed in that direction too as we go through these things. James says, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. We can count it all joy because we know that the Lord is at work in us, and in doing so, He's at work through us, because there are those that are watching, telling us to love one another, to reach out to one another. Verse 5, back in 2 Corinthians, he says, "For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also abounds through Christ." As the sufferings of Christ, Paul in this, he's talking to the church here at Corinth that are going through the dealings and the persecution of the Jews that were unbelievers, that didn't believe Jesus as Messiah. They were also having to deal with these Jewish believers, that the Judaizers that wanted them to go and get circumcised and observe all the law. And they were also having to deal with the pagans around them, the pagan religions and everything that many of them left when they came to Christ. And sometimes it was violent, but not always. There was all these things going on, all these sufferings from outside, not to mention all the things that were going on in their lives. As these people came to Christ, it caused division in their own homes. Husbands and wives split up, families torn apart, as it is oftentimes, even today, even in our country. There's all these trials and these things that we go through that are afflictions, these sufferings of Christ. It doesn't mean that you got to get beaten, whipped, and nailed to a cross in order to relate to this, but the things that have changed and become difficult in your life because of your relationship with Christ. Not to mention just the things that come, the sufferings that come just with being alive here on this planet. So there's all of these things, and he says we're going through them. He says, "For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us," and they abound, don't they? If we want to be negative about it, we can always find something to go, "Poor me, I'm suffering through all this." You know, you ever been around those believers and everything? You ask them what's going on and what they've been doing. "Oh, I'm just suffering for the Lord." Yeah? Why? What's going on? "Well, you know, why don't you put your eyes on the Lord?" And you know, because it says as these sufferings, as this stuff happens, as life happens, And it happens to believers, as it happens in everything, and it does, and it abounds sometimes, doesn't it? As these things are happening and they abound in our, so our consolation also abounds through Christ. He says we can come to Him when them little chihuahuas are nipping at your heels. And when that big old hungry grizzly bear is tearing your house down trying to come after you. When he's got your head in his mouth. Then that consolation and that comfort of Christ is there. No matter what, isn't it? The more we need, the more comfort, the more consolation that we need in our life, the more He has for us. There's never been a time in our life as believers where we would go to the Lord and say, Lord, I've got this giant tribulation, this big trouble in my life and everything like that. And the Lord just looks at us and says, you know what? That I don't even want to deal with that. That's too much. You're on your own. But His response is anything too hard for the Lord? As we go through, we give this thanks in our prayer and our supplication, and we focus on the things that are praiseworthy, the things of the Lord. We realize that, don't we? Is anything too hard? No. Not at all. The only thing that keeps us from the consolation that we have in Jesus Christ is us. If you don't want to be comforted by Him, if you don't want your hearts and your minds guarded by the peace of our Heavenly Father, don't turn to Him. Don't trust in Him. Don't give thanks. Don't pray. Don't pray believing. Do it yourself. Turn to the things and the ways of the world, because our Father will let us do it on our own if we insist. Remember back in Romans when it talked about us people changing the image of God and all that stuff? Didn't want to believe Him, didn't want to worship Him, didn't want to glorify Him as God? And it says, and He turned us over to our reprobate minds. Okay. Those of us that have had children, raised children and all that, sometimes they get hard-headed, don't they? Any of you ever have a hard-headed kid? Yeah? Any of you ever been a hard-headed kid? Any of you still a hard-headed kid? And there's those times in raising up those children and everything that they insist, I'm going to run straight into that wall. And you can relate to them how foolish of an idea that really is and everything. And when they continue and insist and everything, what do? Go ahead. Boom. And when they're knocked out and bleeding on the floor and everything, you get them up, you pick them up and patch them up and heal them up and everything like that, and you make them fix the wall. And so they say, now, do you want to listen? Sometimes He lets us run into those things and all that. So if we want to do it on our own, if we want to face this life apart from Christ and deal with all these tribulations that come, we can. But there's never a time where we have to. We can always turn our eyes and our hearts and our minds on Jesus Christ and say, thank God I'm here with you, never without you. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank You so much, Lord, that we can say that. And we can come boldly to Your throne, our Heavenly Father, and trust in Your love for us. That, Lord, whether You deliver us from these trials and tribulations or see us through them, Lord, that we can trust in You. And Lord, we can count on that consolation, that comfort, that peace, because You're a God of peace, a God of comfort, a God of mercy and compassion. And You love us with an everlasting love. And we thank You, Lord Jesus, that no matter what we go through in our life, good or bad, that we can always say, thank you, Lord, that we're here with you and not without you. Thank you, Jesus, for that kind of love that only you can have.